We're live in New York at Hairstory Studio with Wes Sharpton. I'm really excited to be here because I see his work on Instagram, on Facebook all the time, kind of representing the brand here, Hairstory Studio, and I'm so into his work, and every time we've shared it, people have had incredible reactions. And Wes is going to be doing a live haircut for us here. And take it away. Let us know a little bit what you're going to be doing with Kelly today.
So with Kelly, I often like to look at things a little bit differently, right? It's not so much being technical, but it's also about being able to see something in a new way, right? To look at hair in a new, different way. And for us, what we kind of talk about is the thing that moves me the most are editorial images. And so with Kelly, she inspires me instantly. There's an editorial kind of quality about her that I can imagine her when we were shooting or what we want to make. So today I'm asking myself a simple question of what do I want to see and what's kind of hidden right now? What's disguising the thing that I think is the most beautiful about Kelly? And the thing that I find beautiful that's a little hidden right now is the length is a little distracting. And I want to bring it up to about here, because I feel like that's going to be cheekbone. And to achieve that, I'm just going to start by setting this hair in. And setting hair in is kind of it's an undercut. But what it does is it reduces the hair down to a point where I don't get something that's too bulky. So that's really what I'm looking to do, is just reduce at this moment.
Our audience is growing. Thanks for joining us, guys. You're in for a real treat here. Wes is a brilliant hairdresser, a brilliant hair cutter, works here at the Hairstory Studio in New York City, which is founded by Michael Gordon, which maybe we'll get a surprise cameo from him. There he is in the corner watching, making sure we're doing everything the right way. And Wes is about to get started here. What tool are you going to be working with today, Wes?
I'm going to be working with a razor today. I like the razor for my work.
Trying to get a good spot here.
Yeah. Because it diffuses hair in a really great way. It softens it. It makes it more malleable. I find that I can build shapes that transform into being something that's a little more lived in. But also at the same time, it can be blown out and be quite slick.
Adrian Lopez says, hi guys, thanks for joining us. Adrian joins us all the time, I think down from New Orleans. Gonna be down there to see you guys soon. And we welcome questions here. We want to be as interactive and engaging as possible about the haircut, about Hairstory Studio and what it represents, and of course any questions that you have for Hairbrand. So getting started here, is you going to kind of put in the baseline or the outline?
I'm really going through and softly setting all of this in. I'm using the flat of the blade. That really allows it to set in really, really nicely and hug closely to the head. Like I mentioned before, this is about reducing this so that I don't build up too much weight as I move into the line. And the line has to meet, it has to connect from the back to the front. And I really want it to be showing off a bit more cheekbone. So it's gonna be above the chin and between the cheek.
So when you do this kind of like type of undercutting, is it something that you have to explain to the client, or is it just so subtle that it just marries with the haircut?
Well, I look at it as a function. I think for a long time, it was kind of a little like skate or die, you know, it was a real aesthetic choice. But for me...
Did you say skate or die?
Skate or die.
I think that.
Like a little
hashtag undercut. Skate or die.
It's like, let's do something edgy, you know, let's cut the back off. But this actually does have a function for me. It is about reducing it, but would I explain it to a client? Absolutely. I think that people oftentimes, whenever they're getting their haircut or have had a haircut, they do mention, oh, the back gets so bulky, or sometimes it will look a little baggy, if you will. So
it's kind of the first thing that grows out on a bulb, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah. So if I can set this in, then it just allows it to grow out a little bit better without it feeling bulky or baggy.
Anna Marie Taylor says, hi, Wes.
Hi.
She loves you.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah. Carla Zavala loves Mondays because of Hairbrain Live. Thanks. Lee Clapson is watching. Lee's another incredibly talented razor cutter. We got to get out to Philadelphia and hook up with Lee real soon and do a Hairbrain Live. I think that would be fun.
Change the angle for you guys.
Change of the angle.
See what's going on from this way.
All right, guys, we definitely encourage your questions. We're joined by some of the Hairstory Studio crew right here live. You guys want to introduce yourselves?
Hey, I'm Brian.
Right on.
I'm Jason.
Hi, I'm Gina.
Yep, so these guys work with the brand or they're independent hairdressers that use the brand. It's exciting because this is something a little bit different here. And it's not just about product, it's about kind of approaching things in a slightly different way, which is exciting. Nick Sansone joined us, our good buddy Nick. All right, we have a question here.
Yeah.
What shape are you creating?
Well, I'm going through and I want to create a bob shape. What my feeling is that it's going to land right in here. And I want something that's a little strong in here. So it's going to be more, I would consider this a more classic shape because I also don't want to overstyle the hair. And I think that one of the things that makes hair more interesting and more modern is when you cut a very strong classic shape, it allows the person who's wearing it to...
Let me just try to get a better angle.
Yeah.
There we go.
To let their natural texture come out. And you don't have to epically blow dry it. She doesn't feel the need to necessarily flat iron. Although those are options, but I want to create a really strong classic shape.
I think that's always the winner, huh? When you take the classics and put a unique individual spin on them. You know, I don't think hair changes as much as people think it does. You know, we've got short pixies or crops, we've got bobs, we've got long layers. It's just the way that you modernize it through your technique. You know, I think often when people see something they haven't seen before in art and fashion or design, the first response is that it's ugly. And we have to be really careful with that because we're beauty professionals and, you know, we're not necessarily doing abstract art. And I think this is that's one of the reasons why I love the razor. Anna Marie Taylor says hi to Michael Gordon as well. I'm assuming she's a big fan of Hairstory Studio.
She is.
Guys, we definitely encourage questions. Let me refresh here. Sometimes I bet there's a lot of questions waiting. And Wes, you can catch us up on where you're headed with the haircut.
So right now what I'm doing, I often think whenever I'm using the razor is the stroke of the blade is really important to me. And one of the things that it kind of, how it made sense to me between a broad stroke and a tighter stroke is I actually think about my grandmother's sewing machine and she used to have this zigzag stitch on it and you would turn the knob. And so whenever I'm looking for something stronger, I want those little zigzags. And when I want something looser, more languid, then I'm gonna go for something more broad. So while I'm in the internal part of this haircut, I'm really being kind of broad about it because I want that sense of separation, I want that diffusion, and I want something that's a little more seamless.
It's like it just travels right through your fingertip and you're kind of sketching in the line. I love that, or sewing in the line.
Yeah.
We have a great question here that comes up a lot with razor cutting.
Mm-hmm.
Are you using a guide?
I'm using references.
I love that.
But I'm not necessarily using a guide.
Yeah, not in the traditional sense of a blunt line
right.
That you just keep adding to. But you look through the hair and you can see what you've previously cut.
Exactly.
And the beauty of great razor cutting is you can actually change each section based on how you vary that stroke, as Wes was just talking about.
Exactly.
It's a great comment from Adrian Lopez. Sounds like you're creating options, not requirements.
I love that
philosophy.
Yeah, I think 100%.
Bo Bollinger has joined. Looking good, guys.
Wes, let's talk about the type of sections that you're taking in terms of maybe like elevation or any kind of technical.
How do you choose to take this type of section for this cut?
Well, I think it more depends upon the hair itself. So obviously density comes into play, but it's really more,
If the hair was thicker, would you take a smaller section or?
Yes, yeah. I would. I'm not so much of a, I understand how to pull hair out to kind of achieve a certain effect, but I wouldn't say I'm not that 90 degree guy. I'm not that person. Mm-hmm. For me, I'm really, whenever I've done that type of cutting in my life before, I found that for myself, and this is just for me, it kind of slightly disconnected me from what was going on. So this allows me to be intuitive.
That's the word I was looking for. I love that. And intuitive rather than technical.
Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, tell us a little bit about your background, because I know a lot of people have been seeing your work across social media with all the great output of content from Hairstory Studio. What's your history? How long have you been hairdressing, and how did you get to this incredible position?
I have been hairdressing for around 17 years now. It's funny,
you so say that, you, were 10.
You forget, right? Like, you're like, wait a minute, what is that number? and then you're like, whoa. But yeah, it's been about 17 years now. And I came from Oklahoma. And I moved to New York. And that's where I met Michael at Bumble. And I really I wanted to work primarily with Michael because of the fact that I just felt like he created something special, something new in the world that I could be excited about. And I loved the way that he looked at hair. And so I worked there for a while and I trained at Bumble. And I think that the training was really important for me because at this point, what's really important is that I can actually trust my fingers to do the work that my imagination has created in my mind. So
that's where the discipline comes from in training.
Exactly.
Know the rules and then break them.
And it becomes secondary at that point. You know, I can actually see it for the person now, whereas I'm not getting lost being like, is it the right angle of the blade? So that's why I went there. And then Michael, when he started Hairstory, he said, I have something, and
I have something.
I have something going on.
I have something,
and
Michael Gordon.
Yes, and it was really probably just that much information. Like, but I knew. I think that for me in my life, what I've learned is that you really in this industry you have to pick your heroes. And I didn't know any information. I didn't know what it was gonna look like. I didn't know I was gonna be standing here with you guys doing this, but I knew that I could trust his vision.
Okay, we have a question about what type of razor you're using. And this comes up a lot. Is it a cutthroat while using a razor like that without a guard? Is it safe? What type of razor is it? Tell us everything you know about the razor.
So this one is a flyer, and the thing for me, what I think about when I think about a straight razor, even though I know that that seems very scary, but in a very simple way to think about it, I think about whenever I've used a guarded razor, it's kind of like a butter knife. And a butter knife is not going to give me as clean, as sharp as a cut as if I were to use a steak knife, right? So this allows me to be really precise when I need to be precise because I can always take more weight out or break a line up, but I can't really go back if the hair is shredded unless I cut it all off again. So this gives me the option. So I like that about it.
I always like to say that using a guarded razor is like chewing on a piece of candy with the wrapper still on. Can't quite savor it the same way. And of course, safety is important. And I noticed is something that I teach when I teach razor cutting called lock and load. And you can see how Wes has his pointer finger locked around the blade, pulled far away from the comb. Right there, that eliminates 80% of accidents.
Yep, exactly. Yep.
Technique and control.
And I think if you're gonna give yourself the time to go and start practicing a razor, right? You know, find a friend, find a waitress, find a muse that you really, really, really love and give yourself a couple hours And if you need to, if you're nervous about that, you can always wrap your fingers in a Band-Aid or something like that pre-hand. But I always say, you know what, I've taught people, and like we always say, if you don't have wounds, you weren't really in the war, right? So it's okay.
You know, the strangest thing for me at this point, after 25 years, he's got me thinking about how long I've been cutting hair. The worst cuts that I get are from a scissor always, because it's two blades. Mm. And once they close, they cut through that meat.
Yeah.
Where so one blade, one blade, not so bad. Another technical question, are you trying to make any type of a weight line, or will that just diffuse into the undercut?
I'm actually trying to not have a big weight line. So what I'm trying to do is I'm broadening my stroke at this in the time when I'm in the back so that I don't have a big weight line. So it all kind of sets seamlessly as it's building in the shape. But as I'm moving forward, what I'm doing is I'm shortening my stroke so that I want something that's really strong, really considered, and really deliberate on her.
That's the beauty of the razor. It's very transient. You can travel from one place to another and completely change the texture of the hair within an inch. So you can use those bigger, broader strokes like Wes is using when he starts out in the back, and then you can close it down and shrink it down towards the front, and to be honest, almost get a clean line.
Yep.
Yep.
I think it is. I think it can be a very clean line. And I love the idea of kind of being within each section of hair and kind of asking yourself, what does this section need? Sometimes it needs more strength and sometimes it needs more softness. But that's a real game of you being aware as you're working, which I think is always
really being in tune to the fabric and the density that you're working with. Great. So Sean Hunter Mark loves the results a razor gives because it's never a fresh looking cut.
Exactly.
It's a bit grown in and undone right from the beginning. When I first started razoring for myself after I left Sassoon, the first thing I did was wanted to be a really bad boy. So I picked up a razor, and what someone told me is it makes the hair stonewashed. You know, I guess that shows how old I am, because yeah, there were still acid wash and stonewashed jeans. And so instead of having like your stay pressed jeans, which is like your geometric cut,
it's
a stonewashed denim. Now, if anyone out there knows stonewashed,
I have
stonewashed
jeans.
Yeah, acid wash.
I like them.
You know you're old when something has come back into style.
Well, I think the thing for me is that there is this level of diffusion that happens within the line, and I really like that because it grows out better for the client and or whoever is wearing it. That's really important. That's kind of, it allows someone to go a month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months. So I think that when I think about the quality of something, I also am thinking about the longevity of someone wearing it and it transitioning over time. And it doesn't ever really get bad. It's just you get to a place where you need to restart.
Can you tell us a little bit about this space that we're physically in? What is the Hairstory Studio? And what is this room that we're in? What's your daily life like here? Just tell us about it.
Well, it's all magical, of course.
It's Disneyland.
Exactly. Well, we've often been compared to the Andy Warhol factory of hair. There's models that have been like street scout that are coming in, new girls, recurring girls. People are producing content at a big, huge table, and then. So my daily life is really a lot of cutting hair and a lot of meeting new people and shooting continuously. And it's really helped me train my eye to.
So back to a technical question. I saw that you just, you were using the razor in a slightly different way. You were kind of taking out little bars of weight. Can you explain what that does to the hair?
Well, I'm looking for a sense of separation. Like we said earlier, for in this haircut, back here, I think if it built up too much weight, because her hair naturally gets expansive, we would get a bit of too much exaggeration out here. And that's not what I'm looking for. I still want this to hug in a really nice way back there. So by broadening my stroke, it allows me to create a sense of separation and also diffuse the line
Right, so you can actually create a line, but then go in and actually take out bars of weight, separate the hair, slice through it with the blade on the vertical.
Yep, I think that that's really important. I think for me, I'd rather build the line first and then deconstruct it later. Because then, if I get rid of it in the beginning, like I know some people like to take out weight and then cut the line, I like to cut the line and then take out waves.
Yeah, because you can't put it back.
Exactly.
But you can take more away.
Exactly.
Okay, so we had another question that comes up very, very often with razor cutting. What type of texture do you not razor cut? Are you afraid, or do you recommend not using the razor on curly hair, or you feel comfortable razoring on all types of hair?
I don't think it's necessarily the type of hair, but I do think I have to ask myself one question. Does this need strength or does it need softness? And that could happen in any texture of hair. So sometimes I will opt for a scissor because I feel like something needs a bit more strength in that moment.
Great question. I mean, the way I've always answered it to people is like, it's not the razor that does the damage, it's the way that you engage it with the hair.
Right.
You know, so I find the safest way to razor any texture of hair is with the blade as perpendicular to the head as possible. As you start to get more parallel to the head, and you start to slice down the surface of the hair more, you have to be careful.
Right.
And so it's all about the user. Again, a question from Tom Pascal, what razors do you recommend? Generally, most people that razor cut the way Wes and I and Brian and Jason do use the feather plie. It's modeled after the original French razors from the turn of the century. It's a beautifully balanced razor. And the truth is, if there was anything out there that was better than that, I'd be using it because every manufacturer sends me all their tools and it's still the best straight edge razor out there. All right, great. So how's the haircut progressing? Tell us a little bit more about where you're at in this stage of the game.
Well, right now I'm just finishing up the overall shape of the haircut. And then once that's done, I'm going to start to look at things, evaluate them, and really ask myself, what does it need at this point? And then we'll move on to bangs. Like sometimes once I'm done with this line, sometimes you look at it and you go, maybe it needs a little bit more weight removal. Maybe this haircut requires layers. But it really is for me about starting with that strong base.
Do you ever cut the bangs first?
I have, for sure. But for me right now, In this circumstance with Kelly, I'm feeling that one proportion affects the other. So I want to see what happens to the bangs once I bring this line up. That'll kind of dictate where I'm going to go.
So funny, look at the picture behind you.
Where is
Freya,
it?
Freya, look.
Freya, no.
The short one, it looks like Kelly.
The left, keep going.
Back.
Keep going. I'm so confused now.
Yeah, look.
I'm sorry.
Just like an arm.
Right, right.
Yeah. And look.
So Josie DiCarlo wishes she could watch all of this because she's working between clients. But the thing that's great about Facebook Live is this will live on the Hairbrain page forever. So unlike Periscope, which is why we moved away from Periscope, this will be on the Hairbrain page forever. So you can go back and watch it as many times as you want. You can even add questions later on. And Wes and myself and the Hairstory team will look at the questions for the next few days and make sure you get answers and follow-ups about Hairstory Studio, about the products, about what's different about them, and of course about the haircut, because that's what we're really all about. What do you look for when it comes to thinning hair with the razor? That question comes from James Arness Miller. Do you use the razor to thin hair? That term always kind of,
that's a bit,
it's a scary term.
I think that
we remove bulk. Sounds so much chicer.
I think that I'm often looking for a sense of separation. Which I think is different than,
which is what you can tell your partner when you're over them, right?
Exactly.
For a sense of separation.
That's a good one.
Not this one.
Another continent.
Yes, I mean, you know, obviously, when you're working with the razor, you can look through the hair. And when you see dark areas that are solid and they feel like they're stuck together, as Wes says, you can use the tip corner of the blade to create a sense of separation. But if you can already look through the hair and it doesn't have any of that density, then you don't need to. So you switched to the scissors for the bangaroonies here.
Yep.
Tell us a little bit about it.
I like...
That's Australian for bangs.
Oh, I love that.
I just came back from Australia, so I picked up some of their terms.
Well, I'm looking for a sense of something a bit stronger. Also, I find that I can go through with a bang. And I'm always, like I said, I really like things that feel more editorial. And I find that I can bring a broader section and I get a slight bit of erratic bluntness to the front of bangs that reminds me often of really great editorial wigs.
But it's so funny because we just had a question from Donna Mills, why aren't you using a scissor on the fringe? And then you just explained that you are using one, so that's great, Donna. He had that definite feeling. We've got a lot of our Philadelphia peeps watching. Emily Costello says hi. Emily is another brilliant young hairdresser. She's going to be featured at the Teach-In in Las Vegas. And then we have Josie DiCarlo. It seems like a lot of great people coming from Philadelphia. Hey, Evan, we are not, Hairbrain is not going to be at IBS Vegas, but we have a huge presence at Cosmoprof Beauty Week. We will be at Naha, and we'll be presenting a teach-in the day after Naha.
We do have a lot of friends in.
We have a lot of friends who are going to be in Vegas. Douglas McCoy, DJ Muldoon. Actually, Douglas McCoy just joined on. He said, hey, Wes.
Hi.
Douglas is another great razor cutter from Spokane, a big part of the Hairbrain community. Okay, we've got a question from Abigail Jane Bailey. Do you think that you have to be a master stylist to do good razor cuts, or do you think a beginner stylist can be taught the razor from the beginning?
You know,
take it away, Wes.
You know, we talk about a lot here, and I don't know if it's about master or whatever. But what it really is it's about 100 haircuts, right? It's about 100 of the same haircut. And then at the end of that, you're gonna really get it. It's gonna really be in you. So we say, do 100.
Yeah, I think that's a great, yeah. Like 10 of each classic cut.
Yep.
To really get the dexterity and control, I agree. And I speak from experience because, you know, I've run a lot of training programs, and at some point we did say, hey, you know what, if we're all about razor cutting, why are we teaching them, you know, a classic geometric bob? Why don't we teach them a razor bob from day one? And the truth is it produced weaker hairdressers with less of an understanding. You know, but sometimes I like to say, imagine if you spoke Latin. If you spoke Latin, you could probably then pick up every important language very easily. So learning the classics with the scissors, like Latin, doesn't mean you need to use it every day, but if you speak Latin, you're gonna speak French, you're gonna speak Italian, you'll pick it up really, really easily. We had a really nice comment here. There's so many comments coming in, it's hard to, I think it was from someone named James, who's from Canada, who spent time here with you guys and said he misses it.
Oh, hi, James.
Yeah, such a magical place.
Yeah, James is so lovely. Yeah.
Just trying to keep up with you guys.
James Mendoza from Fabric Monet loves Hair Story, loves what you guys are doing. A lot of love here.
A lot of love, James, too.
Absolutely. They love you too, James. All right, I'm just trying to refresh to find the questions. And why don't you catch us up on what you're doing now? You're putting a little bit of the magic juice in there.
Yeah, I love Kelly's natural texture. I think that she has a great sense of separation. And so I'm just really wanting to encourage that. I don't want it to be forced looking or overly coiffed. I want it to look like it just happened. What is it?
So we have a question here. What exactly did you put in the hair? Can you tell us a little bit more about it?
Yeah. This is Hair Balm.
From Michael Gordon.
Yes, by Michael Gordon. So Hair Balm is amazing. It's one of my all-time favorites. I use it a lot to diffuse hair. I use it a lot to create a sense of separation, even on dry hair as well. It's a lot of moisture, but it doesn't weigh the hair down. So it has a little bit of hold. So I'm gonna get that definition. I can also use it in multiple ways. I love to actually go through really wet hair, comb it all the way through, create kind of a wet set with it. That's been where I've been most recently. But I just wanna enhance this texture and not I just wanted to
change it or manipulate it.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm not. I think that forced hair is not really where I'm.
It looks forced.
Yeah, it just looks forced.
It looks cool, but...
It's just
cool. So for those of you that are joining us that don't know, so Hairstory Studio, that's where we're shooting from right now. This is West Sharpton. And this is kind of a collective place where great hairdressers come together to work and share their work. But it's also a product line. Mm-hmm. And it's a different product line. It's really developed for indie hairdressers. And it goes kind of against a lot of conventional wisdom. And it's kind of not more is more. It's... less is more. Mm-hmm. There are how many products in the line now, Les?
There are four.
Four. And how many new ones are you going to be adding?
I don't know. I don't think...
Not many, right?
I don't know that we... Yeah. As something needs, you know, it's all need-based, right? So we're not into making stuff to just make stuff.
Right.
Right? That's not our position. And what we don't make in particular is we don't make masking conditioners.
Right.
Which I think is huge to the point that because we don't put detergent in new wash, right? So we just wipe that whole category out. And I think that's what's fascinating for me is once hair returns to its optimal place, its natural state of greatness, then you don't need a million different products to manipulate and to put a band-aid on the fact that you've actually kind of destroyed it with detergent.
So I think, you know, from a product point of view, obviously this is something new and different. It's kind of a less is more strategy. But what's really intrigued me from day one when Eli contacted me about Hairstory Studio was the business model is completely different. I think, you know, many of us who are or have been salon owners are used to having to buy literally tens of thousands of dollars of product and dedicate hundreds and hundreds of square foot in our space to product and product sales, where the idea here is it's all direct. You're a referrer as a hairdresser. You focus on your craft, you focus on catering to your client and creating things for them. Then you use the product and you refer it to them and they purchase it online. You don't actually have to keep a huge stock. Mm-hmm. And what I've always said to most salon owners, most salons, if they added two or three chairs instead of four or five racks of shampoo would have a better business. I've always believed that. And when I first saw this concept, I said, someone's finally got it right. So I'm excited about it. You know, I'm a student of the industry and I think there's lots of great business models out there. It's so exciting to see a new one. All right, so let's get back to this finishing touches here. You've put some product in. Are you gonna do any blow drying or are you gonna let her air dry naturally?
I'm tempted to let her air dry more naturally because I think it looks so great.
It looks great. I'm right there with you. That's all I ever do.
So I don't think that really going through and blow drying it is actually necessary. I think you can see the shape. I think you can see the sense of separation. But most importantly is that I feel like you can see Kelly. Like that's like, now I'm getting like, cheekbone, which was our greatest goal, and now because we brought up the bangs, I can look at her and it really shows Kelly off in the most exciting and interesting way to me.
Question, Kel?
No, we're good.
Yeah, I think that really speaks a lot about haircut. A great haircut doesn't need a lot of styling. If you were to do more styling, of course you'd have other options. And I think Kelly obviously could do a lot of different things here. Yeah, how does it feel, Kelly?
It feels great.
Yeah. Wes, for those people that have maybe just joined us, do you want to maybe recap and explain what you did from the beginning?
Yeah, so what we started off talking about is how Kelly had been a little hidden. Like the hair was really distracting from how gorgeous she is. And I like to start the haircut with a simple idea, which is, what do I like about her? It's the more that I get into this job, it's more about discovering the beauty in someone and then exposing it and eliminating the obstacle so they can see it. So it was a lot longer and we also had some shorter bits, which could also help me determine that I could bring that line right in between the jaw and the cheek. And now we're seeing more of this and I want a little bit of that expansiveness so this becomes even wider, right? So we get all cheekbone, which I think is super exciting. And then bringing these bangs up just a little bit so that you kind of know exactly where to focus in on Kelly. So I think when people look at her, even though the hair looks great, you're also actually just looking into her eyes a bit more.
So we do have a question that from Dylan. If you were to style it, what type of brush, like what would be the way, if you did want to blow this out or blow dry it, what would you do?
Well, I think that for us right now, I think what we're really focused in on is mostly things looking as if they weren't overly done. So what I would actually do is I would actually probably use just a small Mason Pearson brush. And I would take it because I would blow it very smooth. And then I would actually twist it like this. It makes it a little bit flatter. It's not kind of that super barrel curl thing. Mm-hmm. And then when I go back through and I break it apart, it looks like it just happened. So even when I'm in those salon kind of environments where you kind of have a little bit of crunch at times, I'm trying to figure out how can I get this dry, but it also look as if it just happened. It's just natural.
It's beautiful. You look fabulous.
Thank you.
You love it?
Yes, definitely.
Thanks, guys, for joining us here at Hairstory Studio, and thanks to everyone that's hosted us and been so wonderful. We plan on coming back regularly over the next few months. If you're interested in trying the Hairstory Studio new wash, at the top of our Facebook page for the next 24 hours, we're going to have a link pinned where if you click on that link and you fill in the information about your business and you're an independent hairdresser, Michael and the team here will send you a complimentary sample of the new wash, which is their sulfate surfactant-free non-shampoo that for them is a game changer. So if you're interested and you love this and you want to be part of this culture, that's a great way to do it. And then learn more, visit the hairstorystudio.com website because it's become an incredible journal for hairdressers. That's what attracted me to it in the beginning. I said Hairbrain needs to be connected to these people. They're putting out incredible content that's about hairdressing and for hairdressing, and it's opening people's eyes. So click the link and visit us at hairstorystudio.com. Get yourself some new wash. Love you guys. We have a special treat tomorrow night. Special surprise for those of you who've lasted all the way through. We've got a surprise Hairbrain Live with Zgat. They're in town from Croatia, and we're going to cut some hair. Peace.